Welcome back from your coffee break. Welcome, obviously, to Sustaintech Xcelerator 2021 Demo Day. This should be really exciting. They're excited in the wings. I can see them. So this is going to be loads of fun. So a little bit of background, if you don't know about them already. Sustaintech Xcelerator, this is a six-month virtual accelerator, and their aim is really to increase the confidence in nature-based solutions, something we've been talking about quite a bit today already. And the adventure is supported by DBS Bank, by Google, World Bank, the National University of Singapore, Temasek as well. So all together they've come, and then you're going to see and you're going to hear from five startups who are really leveraging technologies and data. So they're leveling up and they're changing the game. Let's find out what they've got up their sleeves.
Morning, everyone, at least for everyone in the Singapore time zone. I'm Bidyut Dumra, and I look after innovation for DBS Bank. Now, I love conferences like Ecosperity because, of course, they bring the best sustainable conscious minds and organizations together. But, of course, I guess the need for conferences like Ecosperity also, I guess, sends a little bit of a signal that maybe institutions and enterprises are, I guess, maybe not the most aligned with the forces of the universe. So there is a need that needs to be addressed. Now, for those that know DBS, we have, I guess, gone through a very conscious culture change program. So we call it culture by design. And there are quite a few case studies out there of how we have basically augmented our organization. And that has worked for us. It's taken us from being, I guess, known as the worst bank to the best bank. And we brought about this culture by design by understanding behavioral science and essentially biohacking a new mindset into the organization. And we did that very consciously by leveraging on tools and techniques, nudges and rituals. So we took that approach and said, what if we applied it over here in this context? If organizations and institutions are not aligned to the forces of the universe, we stretched our imagination to think at the other end, who is most aligned to the force of the universe? The obvious answer, the Jedi. Yes, the Jedi. The Jedis are highly sensing and highly attuned, and they make decisions that are to the advantage of the universe rather than taking advantage of the universe. So we thought, simple. What we need to do is bring the Jedi mindset into organizations. And we said, okay, how do we go about doing this? Because if we do get the Jedi mindset in organizations where people are thinking about the universe, they are going to be conscious in how they reshape their products, services, and operations to be more balanced. And the call that we heard through a number of the talks is that this reshaping will require innovation. I'll take it one step further. It requires not just basic innovation. It requires Jedi innovation.
Thank you.
So what is JEDI innovation? So JEDI innovation is about looking at unlocking new value by bringing in change, but being conscious, very conscious to those decisions to make sure that they are looking at the imperatives of today, but also understanding the trade-offs that might be there for tomorrow. So you said, okay, how and where are these decisions made in institutions? And we found that the most common place where big decisions are made is through this very common practice of a business case or an investment case. And I looked up Wikipedia, which is the Star Wars community, their version of Wikipedia. And I found that even the Death Star, there was a business case by the Galactic Empire on building it. And what we found is that in these business cases, they generally look at three lenses. So they tackle three key questions. The first one being, is it desirable? Does it pass a test of desirability that our customers are going to pay for it? The second is, can we do it? Is it something that the organization can deliver? And thirdly, can we make a profit from it? Is there value that we can unlock for the organization? So this is where we said, okay, we need to introduce another mandatory lens, the fourth question, the test of universal responsibility. Is it the right thing to do? And this is where we nuanced and said that is it the right thing to do by the customer, by the community, by the environment, generations over time, for today and for tomorrow. And there's a simplicity in it, but it's a simplicity that we find that might be the way forward, is introducing this new lens and saying, how do we bring this into every organization where decisions are made? So the ask is simple. If there is a possibility in your business cases, investment deck templates, your corporate PowerPoint presentations, or even just a poster in your meeting rooms where discussions and decisions are made, put it up there. What would a JEDI do? What would a JEDI do? And there's a purpose to the construction of that question, because yes, it is meant to be bold, it's meant to be inspirational, it is meant to send a strong signal that we want to be on the right side of the decisions that are made. And we know some of these might create discussions that are difficult, and maybe there might be outcomes that are significant or maybe not so significant to start with. But what's more important is the consciousness that these conversations bring to these decisions that are made. And that's key. What we've actually done is we worked with our sustainability office and we built out a complete framework that can help guide this conversation against these different nuances. But the fundamental is not following the tool, but ensuring that that intent is there. So even with Sustaintech X, it started off with asking the question, what can we do more? Is it the right thing to do? So I'm going to invite two JEDI leaders, Mauro from Google and Taku from World Bank, to join me. Tell us a little bit more about Sustaintech X.
Thank you, Vidit.
Mauro.
Hi, good morning, everyone. I'm Mauro. I work for the Office of the CTO at Google. And this is probably my first on-stage appearance since COVID. But I can hear the audience roaring online. Yep. So at Google, we know very, very well what happens when we combine great technology, people, and passion. And when we do that, we know we can achieve lots of things. Amazing things. So when we were invited to participate in this program, we thought it was a great opportunity for us, because we know we are not going to be able to save the planet alone. We know we're going to need the JEDIs. We know we're going to need the next generation, and we want to empower them to be able to use the technology and everything that we have achieved so far and advance further our efforts to save the planet. So, Sustaintech Xcelerator is an accelerator program for nature-based solutions startups that are focusing on nature-based solutions. And it's a collaboration of six organizations that really care about the environment, that care about, you know, they carry sustainability at their hearts. DBS, Google, the National University of Singapore, Temasek, Vera, and the World Bank. And we, when we started this program, we were overwhelmed with the number of applications. We got 300 applications from 60 different countries. We were not even expecting that it was going to be such a reach. And what we found out is that we were able not only to select five, which was a very difficult task because, you know, these companies were all had amazing, really, really interesting solutions, nature-based solutions, but also we were able to provide them with access to the latest technology, everything that we could provide from Google. We also provided a little bit of fund and the minds of some of the very dedicated leaders, technical and business leaders, to provide mentorship to these companies. And we did an ongoing effort. We did so far 75 mentorship sessions, over 10 master classes and so forth, and we continue to do this. But these entrepreneurs that you're gonna see today are, they have been working really, really, really hard and doing the right thing and the thing that we should all be supporting. And today, it's a great pleasure and an honor to be able to present you with the showcases of their work that you will see soon. And to give you a little bit more details about that, my friend Kamata-san is going to talk to you about a little bit more about the effort. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mauro. So since Birgit did a bit of Jedi thing, so just kept me wondering, actually, why I'm here. Am I wise enough to be a Jedi member? Probably I'm not. So I kept thinking about it, actually. Then it happened to be the case that I'm a certified high-ranking teacher of Japanese martial arts or swordsmanship, kendo. So I see that's why I'm here today. Okay. Well, joke aside, the World Bank actually has some expertise in analyzing cost, benefits, and returns of many, many engagement of humankind in terms of economic, financial, social and environmental terms. So we really wanted to contribute to the world in making progress in terms of valuing, actually, the nature-based solutions' impact in the economic term, social term, environment terms. So through the Sustaintech Xcelerator practices, we had the honor of working with fantastic startups. And they're going to really make a huge impact, actually. And this is going to increase the confidence by your investors and the buyers and the sponsors in the world. So my team had the honor of working with Silvera, Trivia, Cloud Agroeconomics, and Rainforest Connection, and Farm Trace. So those entrepreneurs offer amazing breakthrough technologies and possibly transformational impacts, actually. And they are spot on in offering solutions to the challenges many speakers talked about yesterday and this morning. This is about what to account and how to account. This is a huge, huge weakest link we face, right? So I really would like to extend, again, a warm welcome to all the participants of this very important event. And I wish you enjoy the showcases as much as my team enjoyed by mentoring those fantastic companies. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mauro and Taku-san. Just a quick reminder that, yes, the Rebel Alliance needs you. So just remember to find a way to inject that question. Because in the wise words of Yoda, do or do not, there is no try. Moving on to the showcases.
Thank you, Bidu, Moro, Takuya-san, for working together and make this a better world at supporting Sustaintech Xcelerator. I am David Ding. Welcome to our Sustaintech Xcelerator 2021 Demo Day. I'm David Ding, head of Xcelerator at DBS Bank, working with Bidu on innovation efforts. It has been a very humbling experience to working with our inaugural startups, entrepreneurs, like what Mauro just mentioned. And earlier today, you have heard all of us talk about opportunities and challenges. And now let's move on to switch the gear a bit to look at disruptive technologies and innovations, how this can help us to boost confidence and boost, accelerate the adoption and the development of nature-based climate solutions. So on the video you saw, this is quite a journey. We launched this with our six partners, DBS Bank, Google Cloud, National University of Singapore Center for Nature-Based Climate Solutions, the World Bank, Temasek, and Vera. The six partners selected out of the 200 registrations finally landed on these five startups. They are from USA, Canada, Brazil, as well as UK, covering very different aspects of using disruptive technologies, developing solutions that help the adoption of nature-based solutions. We are a true global virtual accelerator. We cut across 8 time zones. So all the founders who are on the screen, we work either early very in the morning or very late at night to cover all 8 time zones. But it's a very, very exciting time, especially the mentors spending all their valuable time together. So these are the five founders who are going to present to you today. I'm the moderator for today's pitches. So in the next 50 minutes, you're going to hear 5 pitches from the 5 founders. And after each pitch, you will ask them 8 questions for them to address. For those who are online, you can also go to the Resource Center and download the Demo Day booklet so you can see a bit more of the details of company introductions. So without further ado, let me get this Demo Day started. So let's get hope and excitement for these technology solutions to boost nature-based climate solutions. So first up, we have Emily Shinzato, the co-founder and director and people performances at Trivia Forest Technologies. Over to you, Emily. She's dialing in from São Paulo, Brazil, and the time now is past midnight at the moment. Over to you, Emily.
How to scale carbon measurement in forest projects around the world. Hi, everyone. It's a pleasure to talk to you today. My name is Emily Shinzato. I'm a forest engineer and co-founder of Trivia Forest Technologies. So before I answer this question, I'd like to propose an exercise of imagination. So imagine yourself as a field worker in the middle of a tropical forest. It's very humid, it's warm, full of insects and animals. Imagine that you have to collect information like diameter or height of hundreds or even thousands of trees during weeks. Now, imagine yourself as a business executive or a director of a large industry in any segment, inserted in a highly competitive scenario and being responsible for implementing net zero policies and managing carbon investments of millions or even billions of dollars. What if you had to make these investments in carbon projects using this type of information? Using low precision equipment, exposing people to dangerous conditions, and at the end, generating very little information for monitoring carbon sequestration. This is actually the reality of the sector. Every year, we negotiated billions of dollars based on this type of information, collecting data in this way. It affects the reliability and the scalability of NBS projects that we consider key to unlock companies' net zero pledge. And the number of companies committed to net zero is growing exponentially. So the question is, how do we reduce the costs at the same time we increase scalability? And the most important, the reliability of these measurements. So with that in mind, in 2016, a group of engineers passionate about forest and tech gathered to found Trivium in Brazil. Our mission is to build a more sustainable future where people and forests are connected. And how does our solution work? So Trivium solution is based in three pillars. So the first one is the ground truth. Here is where we collect the information by autonomous IoT devices developed by Trivium, and we remotely monitor information and climate variables over years without any human intervention. The second pillar here is related to artificial intelligence, remote sensing, and big data. Here is where we transform data into intelligence by applying the most advanced algorithms. And the last, but not least, is the third, is related to data democratization. Here is where any stakeholder can have access to data from anywhere in the world. So they can be aware, save money, make more money by monitoring their forest projects. And we are helping our clients to build an auditable track record of their carbon project. It's a real movie of forest growth. With our solution, different projects can be compared and monitored, allowing a clear understanding of climate effects. The most interesting part of our solution is that the IoT sensor is just one of the data input elements in the system. So traditional data can be collected manually using a spreadsheet or even our mobile device. All this information is sent to the cloud and being processed online. So this is giving us a huge scalability. Our business model is based on a set fee per sensor installed plus an annual fee per monitored area. And to give you guys some examples, we share our business case from a company, our client called Radix, in the extreme north of Brazil, in the Amazon jungle. So they are enabling forest investors to plant mahogany forests, providing more accountability of their projects using Trivium solutions. The other example here is TRC, which is also a company in the middle of the Amazon jungle, where they are studying climate change effects on their forest assets and building their company strategy. And the third example here is a company called Eldorado in Brazil. They have started to replace their manual measurements, and they are qualifying their professionals for a new era, the era of data. And this project here is using IoT for forest measurement, and is the biggest project using this type of IoT in the world. And it was closed and delivered during the Sustaintech acceleration. This is just some examples of a legion of customers that are helping us to build a new future. The solution demand is global. So potential customers from more than 20 countries around the world have already shown interest in the solution. And returning to the question, connecting forests around the world. This is how we will scale carbon measurement in forest projects all over the world. And now Trivium has an open fundraising round. And if you think you could help us on this journey, it would be a pleasure to talk. We are Trivia, and I invite you all to join us as we connect forests around the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Emily. Wow. So let me, Emily is online now. I do have a question for you. So, you know, I think we talk about your mission is really to make a billion hectares of forests smart, right? So how many IoT devices do you really need to make it happen? And also things on that devices, so how many sensors are you going to, in your next pipeline to roll out in the market? Yeah, that's my question for you.
Hey, okay, so we have this target, a billion hectares, right? So we are definitely going to get there, but the way of the number of sensors, it will depend, of course, of a diversity of variables, like biome, species, location, and so on. But I expected around 10 million sensors to get there, around that, yeah. And the moment we are now, it's a little far from that, you know, but we are just beginning. We started our operations. This year we have increased like 10 times, and the expectation of the next year is 30 times. But you know, this is just the way that we are in right now, and we are definitely going to get there, but still we have some work to do.
Absolutely, and you know, we all agree this is just the start, you know, so we need everyone to come and support on the journey. Currently, Emily, their team Trivia, is only in Brazil, so a lot of opportunity to expand overseas outside Brazil market. Thank you so much, Emily. I'm now going to move on to the next pitch. So next we have Jack from Cloud Agronomics. He's based in Boulder, Colorado. Over to you, Jack.
Good morning and good evening. Thank you very much, and congratulations to all of the sponsors and the team members of the Sustaintech Xcelerator this year. My name is Jack Roswell, and I'm the co-founder and CEO of Cloud Agronomics, which uses AI and remote sensing to quantify carbon sequestration and track sustainable outcomes on agricultural lands. So today, you know, agriculture is one of the largest untapped carbon sinks, and it has the potential to sequester hundreds of millions of tons of CO2 from the atmosphere into the soil. And recently, there's this new market to generate and sell agriculture-based carbon credits. Over the past 8 months, almost every major agribusiness from Cargill to Yara to Rabobank and others have launched these carbon programs to actually pay farmers to perform practices which are regenerative to their soil. And in return, project developers originate credits which are either retired internally or sold off to carbon emitters to offset their carbon footprint. The problem, however, lies in the difficulty and cost of actually monitoring and measuring carbon stocks in global agricultural lands. You see, despite innovations in high-performance computing and machine learning that have revolutionized different industries, agriculture has been left out in some regards. And the reason for that is that the primary method of measuring soil carbon levels in farmland today is through physical sampling. So actually sending someone out to walk into a field, collect dirt through a probe, and send it to a lab in a plastic bag and wait for the results. One, it's very labor intensive and costly, especially if you can imagine performing this on tens of millions of acres in different countries. But the other problem from a scientific rigor perspective is that soil carbon actually varies pretty significantly within a field. And so in order to calculate a correct average of soil carbon levels, you have to collect very dense sampling. On the other hand, some competitors employ what's called biogeochemical modeling, which still requires some of the same physical sampling. However, it also as an input requires years of historical data in terms of what practices farmers are performing. One, there's a problem in terms of farmer privacy and farmers having to share this information. But two, it's also incredibly difficult and laborious to collect and record 5 years of historical data about what was sprayed, what were the different inputs and seed procedures, etc. And so, you know, we basically thought about what if there was a way that we could directly measure soil carbon levels globally by still relying on the science of physical sampling, but employing remote sensing and an understanding of how the environment varies and changes soil carbon to actually sample in a smart way based on, you know, how variable soil carbon is and whether or not fields are similar when they're next to each other. So that really brings me to who Cloud Agronomics is. You know, what our vision is to be the trusted standard for soil carbon quantification, which enables the profitable scaling of these carbon programs in agriculture. And so the way that we do that in terms of our model development is we use AI to deliver reliable, accurate, and cost-efficient soil organic carbon measurements. And so we incorporate remote sensing, we incorporate environmental variables, and then, as I mentioned, the models are still underpinned by kind of the status quo of traditional sampling. The difference, however, is that we use this information, like I said earlier, to sample in a smart way and actually decrease the number of samples over time that are required to still meet the uncertainty requirements that registries and governments internationally require. So the way that we do that is using our proprietary models, we're able to estimate in our target geographies the soil carbon levels on every field in you know, a specific target area. So you can imagine, kind of think of Google Maps, right? Google has this incredible ability in their maps function to zoom out and see an entire country, but then as you zoom in, it updates and you can see the variability. And so think of soil carbon as one of those levels. We can predict at a macroscopic level how soil carbon varies within a field, all the way up to a county, state, or even country. And so that's very powerful in helping both NGOs and governments, but also these carbon credit programs and growers understand how soil carbon varies. And then what we do is, depending on what certifications or verification is needed, we'll layer in different levels and different densities of physical sampling to meet those requirements. But what's really powerful is you can imagine that five fields near each other in Iowa might have similar soil characteristics. So you might not need to densely sample all those fields, whereas other fields might be a little bit more variable. And so what we're actually doing is we're able to stratify different areas and help our partners decide how many samples are required and where to sample. Now, this method is actually, for the first time, falls under the approved verification of ACCUs, Australian Carbon Credits. And we're working with international registries to get a similar methodology approved in the US. So again, the real benefits of this technology is, number one, the biggest thing is that this is outcome-based. Instead of looking at practices and then seeing how those are modeled over time in terms of the resultant carbon, we're directly measuring how much soil carbon is there and then measuring over multiple years to track the changes. Number two, these models don't require practice data. So purely physical samples are required, and then Cloud Agronomics can do the rest. We also collect thousands of data points per field instead of the few that you would get from physical samples, which allow us to aggregate into an accurate field level mean. We're also able to have a much better understanding of how soil carbon actually verifies in that field. And then, because we don't have to collect samples in every field, we're one of the lowest cost methods to quantify and track soil carbon internationally. So finally, you know, when you think about our team is composed of scientists from NASA, Esri, Sandia National Laboratories, the United Nations, and Brown University. Our chief scientist, for example, is James Kellner. He runs an international remote sensing lab out of Brown University. And he's also a co-investigator on the NASA Global Ecosystems Dynamics Investigation, which calculates above ground biomass in forests. And so we can employ similar methods to do the same in agricultural lands. Our team also comes from Cargill, from Indigo Ag, from ADM. So we have this really unique team that can bridge the crossover between deep industry expertise and complex scientific and digital analysis. And so in terms of traction, you know, we have about 10 international projects running with the top grain, fertilizer, inputs, and lending companies in the world, as well as NGOs and governments. And we want to give special thanks to the World Bank through the Sustaintech Xcelerator, where we're working to determine how best to apply this technology to smallholder farms and emerging markets, as well as giving us the opportunity to contribute to the WinRock CSU and also World Bank Soil Organic Carbon MRV Sourcebook. You know, this, as defined by many bodies, kind of in conclusion, is really a gold rush. And albeit more technically advanced, you know, Cloud Agronomics is the pickaxe. This will be the tool, the standard tool, employed by growers and project developers to track and monitor global carbon stocks. And we're really excited about this technology's ability to actually answer the industry's questions around permanence, around additionality, around how much carbon can be sequestered, around what are the best practices to perform in different areas. So this is the science, and this can help provide the answers to the industry's burning questions. Thank you very much.
Well, that's soil MRE cloud agronomic. Jack is online with us too. Jack, I do have a question for you. You know, you guys are solving really hard problems, right? And also right now, I know your focus is to scale your solution in USA. So what is your plan for the next 12 months, and how can anyone help you?
Yeah, thank you so much, David. So, you know, as you mentioned, I think really now is the time to act. Every day, new companies come out with new carbon neutrality goals. And so there's a lot more demand than there is supply for credits globally. And we really want to bring agriculture into the conversation. Additionally, you know, I talked a little bit about the cost of sample, but what I didn't talk about is that, you know, labs are actually at capacity in many parts of the world to analyze these samples. So even the largest companies in the world are struggling to get samples analyzed within a few month period. So there really is a need for new technology immediately, because these carbon programs, who are kind of the ones signing up growers and the ones originating these credits, all have goals of reaching 10 million acres plus. But right now, you know, they're nowhere near that target. And so, you know, I think that technologies like the ones that Cloud Agronomics and some of our partners and even competitors are developing are really key to scaling these markets. I think number two, you know, in the next 12 months, what we're focused on is regulation. So as I mentioned, Australia has been a global leader in this space. They have very recently promulgated new regulations, which actually allow for remote sensing and for, you know, artificial intelligence and different models to improve the understanding of soil health and help augment and help decide where to actually collect these samples. And so it'll be really important for, you know, international governments, NGOs, and also, you know, the registries that are really adopting a lot of regulations from the forestry sector to adapt and evolve to the development of new technologies and incorporate remote sensing, which has really been proven to help scale, as you said, David, in the, you know, forestry space. And then finally, it's about scaling the technology. You know, in 2019 and 2020, we were limited by piloted aircraft, right? We had our own sensing package that we mounted on planes and flew around. And so our ability then to have this technical breakthrough that, you know, uses satellite imagery is really compelling, because rather than targeting specific fields, we can begin to monitor global carbon stocks. So, you know, with this new breakthrough, we're looking with our partners to look at, you know, new use cases for this technology. So we're really excited about the 12 months and about proving that remote sensing can really improve and help the physical processes of lab sampling.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Jack. Thank you for your time. Now we're going to move on. You have heard smart forests, and then we have soil MRE. Let's shift the gear to another forest MRE, but this is focused a little bit more supporting the smallholder farmers. That's Farm Trace. Let me introduce Will Sheldon, the commercial director. Over to Will.
Thanks so much for having us. So the image that you're looking at here is of a piece of farmland in Latin America in the country of Nicaragua. And if you'd come here about 8 years ago, it would have looked entirely like it does on the left. Barren farmland that had been cleared historically of forests in order to grow crops. And these subsistence crops are earning the farmer now about $2 a day. Now, about 7 years ago, we started working with the farmer that owns this land to grow the trees that you can see on the right. And since then, by growing these trees alongside their existing crops, that farmer has grown 1,500 trees, which is sequestering 300 tons of CO2 out of the atmosphere, helping to mitigate climate change, and earning additional revenues of upwards of $2,000, helping increase that farmer's income by upwards of 30%. My name's Will Sheldon. I'm the commercial director at Farm Trace, and we're catalyzing tropical reforestation. Now, here's the thing. Small-scale farmers here like Horatio represent one of the biggest and most effective solutions to tackle the climate crisis. There are 500 million small-scale farmers in the tropics who own and operate the majority of land that is available for reforestation and can deliver up to one-third of emission reductions to tackle the climate crisis. But the problem is, while lots of trees get planted in the tropics, very few grow to become thriving forests, which effectively sequester CO2. And the biggest reason for that is that farmers are not incentivized to grow those trees over time. And there are two reasons for this. The first is that farmers just aren't aware that they could be making more money from growing trees as a crop like they do their existing crops. And second, even if they are aware, doing so is really complicated. Commercializing the carbon stored from trees is prohibitively time-consuming, in particular because monitoring is really complicated and relies on scarce expertise, which farmers just don't have. And so it doesn't make it worthwhile for them to grow trees and sequester carbon through them. And while there are lots of farmers that could be growing trees over time that aren't, there's huge demand from brands who have made climate commitments and want to invest in reforestation in order to sequester carbon to reduce their climate footprints. Enter FarmTrace. We help brands invest in reforestation to reduce their climate and carbon footprints and use that money to help farmers grow trees and sequester carbon on that, those brands' behalf over time. To date, we've had over 94% success rate in meeting our tree and carbon targets for brands. And in doing so, we're now working with 3,000 farmers around the world, increase their incomes by growing 5 million trees each year. And we're sequestering 1.5 million tons of CO2 on behalf of brands. And by doing this, we are enabling $5 million of sales of carbon and trees. The reason this is possible and we've had so much success to date is because we have a team with over 50 years of experience building some of the largest and most high quality reforestation initiatives in the tropics. And our on the ground experience, combined with the PhD level expertise we have in the team, has meant that we've been able to build a simple, elegant, and practical solution that is effective on the ground to help farmers grow trees and commercialize those impacts. And this is how our solution works. Farmers and the organizations working with farmers upload simple farm and tree data from where they're growing their trees. We then combine this data with remote sensing and assess it using machine learning analytics to create forest and carbon assessments over time of that piece of land. And then as carbon gets sequestered, we package these impacts and deliver them to the brands that have paid for them. And the way FarmTrace makes money is by taking a small commission on that transaction. To date, the voluntary carbon market is currently worth $5.5 billion and is rapidly increasing, anticipated to be $50 billion by 2030. And we're on a mission to make sure that tropical reforestation is catalyzed through that journey and can use the carbon markets to grow as an effective solution to tackle the climate crisis. We want to become the world leaders in tropical reforestation. And so if you're a brand looking for trustworthy carbon credits and carbon impacts through reforestation, please do get in touch. In addition, if you're an investor and want to have preliminary conversations with us, we'd welcome the conversation. My name is Will Sheldon. Thanks so much for having us. Look forward to hearing from you.
Thank you. Unfortunately, Will can't join us live today because he has to do his last minute travel for some projects. So let's move on to our next speaker, Topher White from Rainforest Connection. He's based in San Francisco. Over to Topher.
Hi, I'm Topher. I'm here to talk to you about Rainforest Connection. We're a nonprofit tech startup, as David said, based out of San Francisco. We believe that sound, it's the sound of the forest that can be used to both study and protect it. And of course, we've heard from some other partners why that's so important. So again, this is our idea. We believe you have to stop illegal logging, right? So what's our solution? Our solution is that the very moment a chainsaw goes off in the forest, the sound can be picked up by a device up in the treetops. Alerts can be transmitted over the cell phone network to local rangers on the ground who can get an alert on their phones and jump on their motorcycles and get out there and stop the rangers on the spot in this very realistic rendition of exactly how it happens in the forest at all times. This does rely, of course, upon a device up in the treetops, originally based on old smartphones, although we've moved beyond this at this point, with very powerful microphones and solar panels that can last for a very long time. Essentially, you are setting up one device that can cover large amounts of area with sound autonomously for years. This is, of course, what one of them looks like up in the treetops. And this is kind of the way it works. Again, no one's listening to these streams. We can pick up the sound of chainsaws automatically. As you can see from this animation, it's pretty easy to pick out a sound of a chainsaw. This one's pretty close. But we'll show you a little bit about how this works out there in the field. The point is that this is using AI and autonomous monitoring to monitor large amounts of area. So let's take an example. Let's go back to Brazil after where Emily just showed us a minute ago. We're going to look at the edge of the Amazon. This is the northern Brazil. You can see there's this ocean of deforestation, but some pretty intact parts of forest. These aren't necessarily traditional protected areas. These are indigenous reserves. This is the Tembe Indigenous Reserve right here. It's about 300 square kilometers of forest. This is the Tembe tribe themselves. They do have the rights over the land, but they don't have a lot of help in trying to protect it. And in fact, when we first met them in 2014, this entire purple area was occupied by illegal loggers, illegal settlers, drug cartels, and the like. And the Tembe themselves realized that they were clustered into these two corners. They would have to rise up and stop it. We were able to provide some of our technology. And luckily, at the same time, they trained 30 indigenous rangers to be able to actually push back, with force, the loggers that were there. And in this case, there was cell phone service in the area, but very, very, very sparse. So again, we're talking about cell phone towers that were a good 20 kilometers away from the borders of this reserve, which is why it's important for our technology. We're able to make use of the trees, the things that are already there. So the great things about trees is they're very tall in the forest, so you're able to put a device up there. It can pick up more sunlight, it can pick up cell phone service from a distance, and of course, even at that height, sound travels even further, which is why we're able to pick up chainsaws from well over a kilometer, sometimes a kilometer and a half to 2 kilometers away. This is what that actually looks like there in the forest. Similar to the chainsaw you saw before, this is all being streamed up to the cloud, where we'll pick out the sounds with artificial intelligence. It's not that impressive to pick up a chainsaw such as this, but if you look at this, the reserve, it's very large, and so here's a real reading from the forest. So very, very faint sound of chainsaw. I'm not sure if you can hear it, but the AI is able to pick it out, and then, of course, send a real-time alert to rangers on the ground, allowing us to scramble, get out, and get rangers to the end of this road. To be able to intercept the vehicles themselves, stop the loggers, disable their equipment, burn the equipment, push the loggers out of their land, and disrupt the logging operations in a place where there is no law and order. They act as the law and order trying to protect their land. And that's what our sort of theory of change is that there's all these groups, maybe not law enforcement in a lot of cases, who are the most impactful people for fighting climate change. As we know, protecting forests is necessary if we are to fight and reverse climate change. And in many ways, it's these guys out there in the middle of nowhere that can do the most. So it becomes our responsibility to build tech solutions for them. That's why we're backed by quite a few prestigious institutions, Sustaintech, no less and prestigious than these. And we look forward to being able to partner with you as well. But it's not just about law enforcement. In a lot of ways, we're trying to find what are the other ways that we can protect the forest by making it more valuable. So again, every device we put up, which again is just a cheap little device up in the treetops, is able to stream live, and anyone around the world can listen in and pick out and listen in just for the pleasure of listening in. But that's not just, of course, for entertainment. We are able to use AI to scan through the database or scan through the sound as it comes in. Here you can see that there is there's actually a sort of a spectrogram. This is a stream of sound coming in from our devices. And we are able to actually pick out the sounds of individual species down to the second resolution, as you can see here. This is the same system we're using to pick out chainsaws in the cloud. We are amassing a massive database, and this allows us to measure biodiversity as well as the intensity of different species distributions simply based upon audio. Audio is incredibly powerful. In fact, I would say it is perhaps the least utilized and most powerful tool out there for measuring and protecting our living planet. Based upon this idea, we are setting out to build this nervous system for the natural world. The same way that your nervous system will tell you when there's pain, when there's heat, when there's fire, when there's a prick, when there's a cut. And of course, that's the pain, that's the chainsaw. But there's so much more you can pull out of it from around the world. The same way the human body is able to tell what's happening in the furthest reaches of your body, we can build the same thing with a network such as this to be able to understand what's happening in the furthest reaches of nature and bring those insights back to us using senses that we ourselves may not have been able to make use of anyway, AI and large-scale acoustic monitoring. That's why our technology, as you can see here, is deployed all across the world, 38 countries so far and many more to come. It's useful in many different ways in which people would try and use it on the ground. This is this idea that we can have take the fabric of an entire area of forest and map it temporally, not just on which species are there at a particular moment, but a resolution from the second stretched out to years at a time and be able to see the way that species themselves move through. This is incredibly, this is most possible with sound, because sound is not limited to just what you can see in front of you, it travels throughout the forest. But these platforms, of course, are only as useful as those who use them. So we want to make use of these same web platforms, as you see here, to allow scientists to go in. If they know a species they can see, they're able to pull it up in our database, circle it right there in the spectrogram. This is a web interface that anyone can use for free. And just based upon that, they're able to say, that's this species, and then trigger off a search through our entire database, allowing you to pull out dozens or hundreds of examples from our years and years and years of audio from each location. And then this allows very quickly people to actually add to our species database that we have, and not just database, but our sort of automatic searching. So here's the result of what you just saw. Here in this just two to five minutes of audio, you're actually seeing almost a dozen species just clustered into this one area, all available. This sort of functionality is available for every second of every minute of every month, year that's in our database across the entire planet. And that, what I think, is what's really in front of us. The ability to make incredible interfaces that bring this raw data to the people who can use it the most. That really comes into play when you start looking for very rare things. Birds are one thing, frogs are another. But this example is a species of elephant in the forest. A Cornell Lab of Ornithology had recorded 120 years worth of audio. And their challenge was to find the elephant. Well, we cross-loaded into our system, had a couple of interns look through it for a couple of days, and indeed they were able to find hundreds upon hundreds of examples of elephants that these partners had been so desperate to find that they were willing to offer this huge database out for free. This is an elephant walking through the forest, grumbling to himself or herself. We think it's beautiful. And this will allow us to build really, really powerful tools to, for example, mitigate human-wildlife conflict, to be able to know when elephants are streaking onto the, oh, here's an elephant further away. Okay, again, this is it's important for us to not think this is such an operation. This is the device that you see up in the tree. It all fits into a bag that can be carried for miles and miles and miles through the forest. Installing it is as easy as climbing a tree, which looks a little harder than it is, but everyone on the ground can be trained to do it, and it's really important for us to make sure that we are not involved in the installation so this can spread into the many hundreds of thousands around the world necessary to achieve our goals. You can see the whole thing can be put up pretty quickly, like this. And it's not just limited to forest. One last thing, we are really focused on the platform. What is everything we can achieve with cloud-based acoustic monitoring? Bioacoustics is a field that almost seems to be defined by its limitations. We want to break through all of those by breaking assumptions. Just as easy as our system works in the forest, you can make use of it underwater, such as here in Vancouver Bay, where these whales, these orca whales, are often in shipping lanes. They want to be able to strip them out. We're able to send alerts to local authorities so they can actually go clear the shipping lanes when the orcas come around, just based on AI detection in real time of these whales. So instead of building this system, they sound so cool. They sound wonderful. So instead of building the system for a singular purpose, which of course is to protect forests originally, we built it in a generic way that allows you to make use of the overall capabilities, possibilities, I guess, of acoustics. And we are just barely scraping the surface of that. So please come speak to us if you're interested in making use of this platform or anything else that we can build. We'd love to work with you. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Tover, for that pitch. Just very quickly, maybe in less than a minute, because your pitch is a little bit long compared to the rest. So what What does it take to build the future you painted in your pitch video about the future with audio, especially though you covered about preventing forest, illegal logging, and now you discover your acoustic can uncover more biodiversity and the bio-related data. Yeah, Topher.
Yeah, I think as your colleague Mr. Dumra was talking about, it really is a case about sort of business cases for nature-based solutions. I think that doing that actually requires far like a higher standard than simply the interest in sustainability. So we need to think about what makes nature-based solutions and in this market like compelling to customers. And I think it's the richness and the depth and the insights we can pull out that really makes it compelling. It really adds the value, just like a richness and depth in for example, nature itself really is what we're looking for. So I believe there's a huge opportunity for measuring biodiversity and frankly, marketing it as a co-benefit within the carbon markets. It's not something that's been done at scale yet. You've seen a small preview today of what we can do with simply audio alone. On one hand, you have this amazing richness and real-time transparency for stakeholders. On the other hand, you have experiences for customers, like you sort of saw. And today, we're looking for partners and customers who are really ready to make use of this technology you saw within carbon markets, specifically leveraging code benefits to bring experiences and much more transparency to their stakeholders and to the customers. We're totally ready to scale. We're doing it right now. We're already in the process of scaling. So we hope that you're ready to scale with us and add so much more value and experience to these markets.
Thank you, Topher, for now. We'll come back to you at the end. Now, let me move on to the next one. Silvera, we have Al from UK, now actually 5 a.m. So he's been waiting since 4 plus to join us. So over to Al.
Hi there. My name's Alistair, and I'm the CEO and co-founder of Silvera. Silvera provides the data infrastructure for carbon markets. Our data ensures that financial assets are truly net zero. The last few months since we joined the Sustaintech Xcelerator here in Singapore has been quite the journey. We raised from Index Ventures and angels, including the current or past CEOs of Thomson Reuters, IHS Markit, Citibank, and the New York Stock Exchange. Normally, you'd see a revenue chart here, but over the last few months, everything has been up and to the right. An incredible team. We should be hitting 60 people by year end. Our ratings coverage with quarterly updates over nearly half the traded market volume. The amount of calibration data we've captured in real forests across the world, collaborating with UCLA, University College London, and NASA JPL, over 500 billion in-field measurements and approaching over a trillion by year end. Also growing the number of traders and buyers using our data and, of course, our revenue run rate. Now, if this is the trajectory, the problem must be equally huge, right? So what is it? Well, we have, incredibly, a $50 billion market in 2030 and 100 trillion of assets without data infrastructure. For carbon, in particular, Mark Carney's Task Force for Scaling Voluntary Carbon Markets state that the offset market primary value, not including secondary trading or derivatives, will be between $15 and $100 billion in just 8 years' time. We're looking at a 50x growth from today's numbers. The voluntary standards for carbon offsets have worked for over a decade to make this even conceivable, but the market is now like an equities market without financial reporting or a debt market without credit ratings. If there's no data infrastructure for carbon markets, there's no data infrastructure for net zero. But in the carbon value chain, this is causing huge pain today. Project developers who actually do the activities on the ground, reducing emissions and sequestering carbon, they can't access finance. They can't get the fair premium for the quality of their projects. And they struggle to secure offtake agreements at terms that work for them. Commodity traders have lacked the information as to who they should finance or secure offtakes with. And the exchanges and banks lack the data to create standard contracts whose specification is defined by actual quality like every other commodity. And buyers lack effective due diligence, but have to manage procurement of 9 or even 10 figure dollar spends in the years running up to 2030. That's right, individual buyers are looking at $1 billion spends over the next 8 years. They need to see their emissions reductions and sequestration investment recognized by asset managers and see savings in the form of lower cost of capital. And that's, there's no mechanism to realize that at the moment. Asset managers have now committed 100 trillion of financial assets, debt and equity to transition to net zero management, but without effective measurement and reporting, not just of emissions reductions, which of course are absolutely foundational and critical, but also the offsets that those businesses use. Only the two things together can make net zero a reality, both on the ground and crucially in the atmosphere where it matters. Silvera's ratings and other data products provide the horizontal infrastructure that forms the trust layer, facilitating these transactions between these participants and meeting all these pressing needs across the value chain. Our ratings cascade into a recognizable AAA through D scale, and our core ratings subcomponents that you see here that are delivered not only by our 20 world-leading AI and technology team, but also an equally strong 20-person team from across the financial sector giants. Our web app and API deliver transparency that underpins these ratings at scale. And for nature-based offsets in particular, our pipeline of geospatial processing processes multiple satellite feeds, ensuring accuracy and timeliness of ratings. With our proprietary machine learning, we transform these feeds into deep insight on not only the carbon, but also the additionality and permanence of the offsets on the ground. And we're pushing the science further than ever before. The work we're doing with our international partners should allow us to 4x the accuracy of the legacy manual in-field measures, but with the global reach and low-cost, high-frequency capabilities of the orbital fleet of satellites that's currently freely available. Our team leads the industry right now with over 200 years of collective experience. Not just multiple PhDs from the best labs and startups in the world, but also deep financial data from the ratings sector, from the legal and finance and commercial routes. So why should Silvera win its segment, and why should you consider working with us? Well, obviously, at the core, our ratings are accurate and effective, holistically blending the financial analysis with the deep cutting-edge technology. We also have a completely independent role, free from conflicts of interest. And as a result, we're trusted to support real transactions in the market today. Adoption in our launch segments in the middle of the value chain is growing fast, and our upcoming exchange launches are something to look forward to, as well as the increasing adoption of our ratings by the largest traders of carbon. On the buy side, we're seeing category leaders in every vertical sign up to use our tools and data. This means by the end of the year, well over half of the nature-based offset transaction value will be informed or supported by our data. The world really needs to deliver net zero. With our data, we can make sure that net zero is real, starting today. If you're interested in achieving net zero for your business or for your portfolio, of course, we'd be happy to talk. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Al. Yeah, I think net zero is really important. I think, you know, even from the last few pitches, it's obvious that forests are very important, right? I think, you know, quite a few of our own cohort echo that importance of forests. However, you know, also in the earlier panel discussion, it brought this additionality as well as permanence. So I just want to get your view about, there's also concerns about this area. So what do you, you know, account for it, and then how do your customer actually think about it in this area as well?
Sure. Yeah, I think the first thing to note is that it is good that people care about additionality and permanence. It really does matter, and it is core to the voluntary standards out there now. Without accounting for it, people and companies would be paying for changes that would have happened anyway or that wouldn't persist for a meaningful period of time. For additionality, our ratings analysts, they run a battery of 22 tests to quantify additionality in a way that makes all projects across the standards and across the methodologies comparable. Our tests, they're not binary, so they allow for degrees of compliance, and they are powered by a quantitative view of the past and recent deforestation in the region that's driven by the satellite data analysis pipeline I mentioned. That gets you like an all of market relative scoring or stack rank using a transparent methodology, and then the buyer or the market can set its own level, which is often, but not always, a bit higher than what's expected by the voluntary standards. For permanence, the issue isn't really that all the world's forests are going to burn down. We would have bigger problems if that happened, but that any given forest that relates to a project might have some kind of impairment. Now, I think companies and investors are well used to managing risk, right? They do it all the time in their capital allocation across their portfolio. What we do is we use a hybrid of a geospatial analysis looking at fire and other natural risks, and then assessment of more human factors like strength of land tenure and local deforestation drivers, so that the level of risks are transparent and the drivers, so the buyers can maintain a portfolio that's more robust. So where this is helpful for our customers in general across the two categories is just having transparency so they can avoid, you know, the expose in Bloomberg because of some project they're associated with, and that they can transact without friction and price effectively and crucially start this cycle of reporting to their stakeholders.
Great. That's all the five pitches. Let me bring up all the four founders who are online. I'm going to invite them just to maybe one each say a sentence or two to just repeat your mission and what is your ask of everyone who can help you to scale your business and all contribute to our net zero goal. Maybe we can follow the sequence. So Emily, Jack, Topher, and then Elle.
Yeah, we are building a more sustainable future where people and forests are connected. So this is our mission, and I'd like to thank you all for this opportunity. It's just amazing.
Thank you, Emily. Jack?
Yes, thank you, David. So again, we're Cloud Agronomics. We use AI and remote sensing to quantify carbon sequestration and also provide analytics to carbon project developers. So really excited to help try to bring agriculture into the lens to solve climate change and to work with some of the largest agribusinesses in the world to take advantage of regenerative agriculture. And congratulations to all these companies. It's pretty incredible what they're working on.
Thanks, Jack. Topher.
Thanks. We're Rainforest Connection. We make use of audio for pulling out unprecedented insights and threat protection from the forests around the world. We're looking for partners and customers who are willing to take this to help boost the carbon market with co-benefits and bring new depth transparency to nature-based solutions in the forest.
Well, definitely not last, very importantly, Elle.
Vera, we're building data infrastructure to support the scaling of the carbon markets and ensure financial assets can and truly become net zero. If that's aligned to what you do, then for sure, let's talk. I wanted to say thank you so much for the opportunity to become to be part of the program. It's been incredibly good, and it's great to work alongside all these amazing entrepreneurs and businesses, as well as the mentors and the backers of the program. So thanks so much.
Thank you so much, all of you. Just a closing, a few sentences. it wouldn't be possible without our partners. Some of them are in the room, as well as our mentors. They spend so much time working with our startups together in this virtual accelerator format. It's such an humbling and encouraging experience. We continue with the next month. So even today is our demo day. It's not the end of the accelerator. We still have a month to go to see how we can collaborate more and turn out more possible collaborations to really, really accelerate possibilities and opportunities. And following what Bidio said earlier, that viability, feasibility, desirability, and responsibility, this together our one mission of all of us together. And with that, I thank you all for joining us, especially our founders who are staying very late and early in the morning, and wish you a great day for the rest of the day. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ding. And thank you to our finalists. What an incredible, incredible opportunity for all of them. Of course, Sustaintech Xcelerator is doing amazing things. As they say, the proof is in the pudding. And today, we've really seen that. And we're just so excited to see these innovations, these technologies, leveraging data, going the extra mile, really showing us what the future can look like and how it's already in operation. Inspiration, to say the least. That is therefore the end.